Praise the Lord. We're doing our compassion presentation today. Most of you know that we sponsor a child through compassion called Hemlatha. But from time to time, compassion send us stories of some of the things that happened, some of the miracles really, through compassion that God's performed in people's lives. So they sent one through and I'd just like to read out, which I thought was quite a heart-moving story. You probably can't see that very well, can you? But it's about he's a man now called Methodi. So I'm just going to read out the story. What does it take to forgive your parents' killers? Methodi was only 6 years old when the Rwandan genocide occurred, during which both of his parents were murdered. Looking back, Methodi says, the biggest thing that happened to me that the government would not have managed to give me is forgiving the killers. God convinced me that I would not be any different if I revenged. I thank compassion because they introduced me to knowing God bit by bit until I got born again and my family followed on. My project helped me discover my singing and leadership talent. I'm learning to accept God's love for me, and in the end, I know He is enough. In the early 90s, Methodi lived with his parents and five siblings in eastern Rwanda. After his family's cows were stolen, Methodi was sent to live with his aunt, as his parents could no longer afford to feed him. But in April 1994, violence erupted, and over 100 days, 1 million people were slaughtered. Methodi fled with his aunt to nearby hills and swamps where they hid. The rest of his family became separated. Methodi's older brother Nelson was captured and killed. His father and sister hid in the local church, but the church was bombed, killing his father. His sister suffered a serious head wound, but still managed to escape when the attackers came into the building by slipping through their legs. She died a year later from her injuries. Methodi learns of his mother's death from another survivor who confirmed she was killed trying to escape with her youngest child. Only two of his sisters, Clementine and Madritis, survived. For 2 months, Methodi and his aunt hid in the swamps with other survivors, constantly moving to avoid detection. One day, the killers came to the swamp to attack us in big groups, blowing their whistles and singing their songs and carrying their weapons. You could hear people begging for forgiveness, saying, "We will give you all that we have." The killers responded by saying, "All that you have is already ours," and called them names as they mercilessly killed them, he says. At that point, my aunt ran with me to the river that was in the middle of the swamp and begged farewell to me, saying, "Your father left you with me to take care of, and now this is the end of our road." She jumped into the river to be drowned, and I followed on as the killers drew closer. It was better to be killed by the water than to wait to be butchered. The water rejected us and we could not drown. We held on to floating dead bodies until the killers found us. They thought my aunt was my grandmother. They hit her with a machete on her head and she collapsed. Then they searched the pockets of my shorts to see if my grandmother had hidden her money in them. Failing to find money, they threw me to the ground, hit my knee with a club, and just when they were about to finish me off, another killer called out to the rest of them, blew his whistle hard and shouting that they had found another place to loot, and I was spared. By God's grace, Methodi and his aunt were rescued and taken to hospital. Afterwards, Methodi tried to join the army, but he was told he was too young. Because of all that had happened to me and all the anger I had, I wanted to become a soldier to seek revenge for my family. I would think about all that had happened to my parents, my family, and my country. And all I wanted to do was become a soldier, get a gun, and shoot all the people I was told killed my family. His aunt was given a house to live in, and Methodi stayed with her. A year later, his neighbour enrolled him into the local compassion project, where he was sponsored. In the beginning, Methodi was quiet at his project, and he was behind in his education. The project workers worked diligently with Methodi, praying with him and ensuring he received counselling and treatment. He recalls through the regular project activities like singing games, praying together and reading the Bible, "I started to realise that I could get peace from God." started singing in the choir and in my prayers, telling God to take away all that was heavy in my heart. People in my family were surprised by the sudden change in my behaviour. In 1999, Dodie gave his life to Christ and was baptised. I started laughing and talking to people more. I got so involved in my church and my class performance improved to either the first position or second in my class. My sister asked me to teach her how to pray because she wanted what had happened to me. She and my aunt are now born again, he says. Today, Dodie is in his third year of university and is the first vice coordinator of the Genocide Survivors Students Association at a national level. There are still scars that he bears, both physically and mentally, but Methodi's past no longer has a bitter hold on him, thanks to the support of many people, including his sponsors, and the peace of God which transcends all understanding. Methodi is firmly on the road to forgiveness and has a hope and a future shining brightly before him. So that's a wonderful story, isn't it? It sort of touched me when I read it, and it's just proof to what God can do in people's lives, and also the great work that Compassion is doing. So we sponsor a child called Kamilapa, which you just about to see up there, and we basically take an offering every month, and any money that's left over goes back into the Sunday at One ministry. So I think Phoebe's going to come round now as we start to sing the next song, which is Wonderful Merciful Saviour. But yeah, if you find it in your heart to give to the sponsorship of him, then please do so. Thank you, I'm up there, the obligation. But obviously we're sponsoring her, and Compassion is helping to feed her and helping with their schooling, and also just telling her about the love of God, and telling her all about Jesus, which is great, and obviously had a very dramatic impact in the story of the young man that we just read about. So we'll sing the next song now. Thanks for listening.
Oh, we hope to see. Thank you, Michael. The story is touching, isn't it? So powerful what the Lord Jesus does in our lives, isn't he? He can do that for each and every one of us. Am I right, Timmy? He's awesome, isn't he, our Lord? He's amazing. I'm going to do what I've been doing lately. I'm not going to necessarily read from the Bible. I'm going to try and tell the story again. But if you want to pick up or see if I'm preaching the right words, turn to Joshua chapter 2. Joshua is the first book after the five books of Moses, the books of the law. The very first book. Joshua chapter 2. Who knows the story about Rahab or Rahab?
She was let down in a basket, wasn't she?
No, she wasn't let down in a basket. That was Saul.
Who?
Saul. He was let down in a basket, wasn't he?
I thought she was. No, she wasn't.
She let them down in the basket.
She let them down. Well done, Hayes. We get half a gold star for redeeming yourself. Before we start, I'm going to pray. Is that right? But it's wonderful to see you all. It's wonderful that you're here gathering and you want to hear the word of God. Sorry? Princess is here? Yes. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, we praise you and we bless you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we just thank you for the amazing work upon the cross. And Lord, as we look back into your word in the Old Testament, we can see a shadow of Jesus, a picture of Christ all the way through the scriptures. And we see that scarlet thread, that scarlet cord going right through the Bible that leads us to the cross at Calvary. We've already sung about it, Lord. At Calvary, mercy there was great and grace was free. Lord, it's free today. And all we have to do is look to Calvary. I pray, Lord, that those in here who are struggling with addiction, those who may be homeless, those who really need to be encouraged today, that they would find hope in our Saviour. That blood of Christ can cleanse us all from all sin. Father, I thank you that you have anointed me to preach the gospel. And I feel like Joshua is, we're just about to talk to him now. He said, Lord, be bold and courageous. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with you, Lord. Just pray now you would undertake for me. I receive the promised Holy Spirit. And I pray that your words would accomplish their purpose. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's a wonderful story. A story of a harlot woman who knows the Lord. Not only that, she pleads for salvation and she hangs a cord, a scarlet cord. What colour is scarlet?
Red.
It's red. And her whole household is saved. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But let's build the context before we go into it. Moses has died. You all know who Moses is? Moses was the one who was sent in by God to redeem the Israelites out of the land of Egypt. Moses has just died. Now he's going to pass on the baton to a man named Joshua. You remember 40 years prior to this point where God tells Joshua to go across the Jordan River to take back what God has promised them, the promised land. 40 years prior to this, Moses sent out 10 spies, and Joshua was one of them spies. And do you remember they came back and they trembled with fear because they said, oh, they're like grasshoppers in our sight. And it was only Joshua and Caleb, I think it was, that said, actually, like puppy pad, let us down, because we know that God is with us. But because of that disobedience, because of that fear, they had to remain in the wilderness for 40 years. Can you imagine that if you did something wrong? And you'd have to wait another 40 years. Maybe that's true. Maybe you have been in the wilderness. But God always teaches us something through that. So here we've got Joshua. This time he's sending out 2 spies to a place called Jericho. Now Jericho was the first place they was going to come to. It's very near Jerusalem. And it was a fortified city. Walls very thick. I'm not sure how thick, but very thick. And he sent in 2 spies. Now, the 2 spies went in, to spy out the land, and they come to a place of Rahab, the harlot. So it's probably a brothel. I could think if there was somewhere you were going to be that you would be inconspicuous in some way, many travelers would probably aim to a place where the harlot lived, to lodge there. Now it's said, and I want you to remember this, it's said that in them days they used to paint their windowsill red. You've seen that, now we've even got that name, the Red Light District, that continues on. I want you to keep that image in your mind, because it's something that I only found out 2 days ago, which blew my mind. Oh, right, sorry, you trying to get up? So they find somewhere to lodge. And the king of Jericho hears about it. I should wonder if these people look different. They probably looked a little bit different. But they were probably asking questions. And he sends some soldiers go banging on the door saying, we've heard that you are keeping some spies who are searching out to see what's going on in our land. What did she do? She hid them up in the roof and covered them over with the flax that she laid on the roof. And she said, oh yes, I know, we have, these guys did come along. They have been here, but I don't know where they come from. And just as the door, the day was breaking, the gates were being closed, they went off and they aimed just out in the wilderness. If you go now, you follow them, you catch them up. Imagine that. Rahab told a little porcupine there, didn't she? Now here we can see Rahab is actually in the hall of faith in Hebrews 11. I'm not sure what circumstance, if you imagine if you had to save someone's life by telling them why, I don't know what I would do in that situation. But we have to remember she's probably somebody who is just about to be converted, and we can't expect too much of her, bless her. But she lied. And just as she came in then, she went up to the roof where the spies were, and she says this. She says to them, I know that, this is, by the way, this is in chapter 2, verse 9. I know that the Lord has given you this land and that a great fear of you has fallen on all of us, so that all who live in this country are melting with fear because of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you come out of Egypt, and what you did to Sihon Og, the two kings of the Amorites east of the Jordan, whom you utterly destroyed. When we heard it in our hearts, melted with fear, everyone's courage failed because of you. For the Lord your God is the God of heaven above and the earth below. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that you will show kindness to my family because I have shown kindness to you. Give me a sure sign that you will spare the lives of my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all who belong to them, and that you will save us from death. Isn't that amazing that she knows about the God of Israel living in Jericho? So they said, okay, look, because of what you've done for us, if you don't tell anyone, when we come back to take the land, we will spare you. So she lets them down by this cord. Now, I'm not sure if this scarlet cord is a rope that they're allowed down, or it's just a rope because it says from the window, or whether they gave her a scarlet cord, I'm not sure, but she let them down, and she said, look, go and hide in the hills for 3 days. Interesting, that 3 days picture in the Old Testament. Go and hide for 3 days, for when they come back, then you can go back and no one will find you. And they said to her this, take this scarlet cord, which is a red cord, and I want you to hang it in the window. Just remember that, the scarlet cord is going across the window. I'll get it in a minute. Right? So I want you to hang that in there, so when we come, you will be safe. But you, all of your father, your mother, your brothers, and your sisters, and all your family, and all of you have, must be in the house. And if there's anybody caught outside the house, then your blood will be on, our blood will be on, your blood will be on your head. But if anybody is touched within the house, the other. Let it be on our heads. So they made this promise, and she said, so be it, according to your words. And she hung this scarlet cord up on her window. Now, it's important to know that her house was probably right on the corner of Jericho, part of the wall. So it overlooked the land, yeah? So here we are, she's done this. The guys wait there for 3 days, the two spies, and then they go back to Joshua, and they say this. Those people are trembling with fear because of our God. And Joshua said, surely the Lord has delivered them into our hands. Now what happens here, Joshua is just about to go over the River Jordan, and I'm not going to preach on this today, but he gets the priests, they take the Ark of the Covenant, and they stand at the edge of the water, and the water heats up, just as it did the Red Sea. It stops, it's going all the way down to the Dead Sea, but it stops. And as the priests are there with the Ark, all the armies march across, all the men. And as soon as they finish, as soon as the priests come up with the river then washes down. And they set up some stones. And they said, every time now people see these stones, they're going to tell of the wonder that the Lord dried up the river. It's the same miracle, but a river. So we know that he's done it with the Red Sea, now he's doing it with the River Jordan. You can imagine the fear that must have struck Jericho. Can you imagine it? But just as the army are at Jericho, Joshua looks up and there's this man standing there with his sword drawn in his hands. And you can imagine Joshua just grabs his sword and he said, are you with us or are you with the enemies? Now he says this, the army of the Lord's commanders says no. But I am the army of the Lord's commander and I have now come. And Joshua fell to the floor and worshipped. I believe this was the pre-incarnate Lord Jesus Christ. Can you imagine that? The pre-incarnate, the Jesus before he came on this earth, has showed up with his sword drawn to Joshua. And he says, tell me what your servant must do. And he says, take off your sandals, for you stand on holy ground. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? The Lord Jesus said to him, what would you do? I'd take my shoes off, wouldn't you? You would take them off, wouldn't you? Joshua took his shoes off. And here the Lord says, it says Yahweh says, it's Jesus, I'm sure it is. He says, I want you now. He says, this Jericho is, in a paraphrase, is impregnable. It's got very thick walls. So I want you to take the Ark of the Covenant. I want you to bring the priests and get their 7 trumpets. Next time. As you march around the city for 6 days, just once each day. And I want you to blow your shofar, blow your trumpets. And then on the 7th day, I want you to march around 7 times, blowing the trumpets. But then on the long blow, I want you to shout. And the walls will come down. Have you got that? Now I want you to do something. When Michael blows the long horn, I want us all to go, ah! Can you do that? I just want to wake you up a little bit. So here they get to Jericho. Now you can imagine how frightened they must be in Jericho. And they get there early in the morning and they march around and the trumpets are blowing. They march around once. And then the 2nd day they march around again. This is what the scripture says. And on the 7th day they march around 7 times blowing their trumpets. But by the end the horns then blow along. I want you to take her out and place her at the edge of the camp of Israel. And it said once she was out, they burned everything and destroyed everything in their sight. Can you imagine that? That is such a powerful story, isn't it? I don't know why Holly would have to feel they have to elaborate on things or twist it. Because you couldn't make that up, could you? Thank you for that shout, that was great. So what can we learn from this? This is a picture of Rahab. Now I want to learn from Rahab. It's a picture for me of conversion. That's where I want to go with it. We're all like Rahab, aren't we? Firstly, she was aware. She had an awareness of God. Even though she was in Jericho, she was a Gentile, a pagan, but she had an awareness of God. She said, our hearts tremble before that God of yours. She even refers to him as Yahweh. But she says, there was such a terror in this city because of your God. We heard of the Red Sea that your God parted 40 years ago. Can you imagine that? 40 years ago. It's amazing that she had an awareness of God. Now it's interesting, isn't it? That's the first thing that came to me when I became a Christian, was an awareness of God, a fear of God. Now God has made himself known through lots of different ways. Romans 1 says that the invisible attributes of God can be clearly seen, that every single one of us is without excuse. Do you know when you go for a walk in the countryside or in the town, every time you see a bird, every time you see a tree, or whatever you see, you have no excuse but to give glory to God, the one true God. Clearly seen. But also God has given us this, his word, which is absolute proof. That's why you don't want to read it, because it's truth. And what we do as a nation, we suppress the truth in righteousness. We suppress it, we don't want it. Oh, I don't believe that. That's an excuse. You do believe it, but you don't want to give your life and be accountable to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do make excuses, don't we? So we push God out. Rahab was like, I'm aware of God, I have a fear of God. I want God to come in. But yet, the king of Jericho wanted him out. Find them, I want him out. I don't want anything to do with him. We do that, don't we? Make excuses. What about this one for an excuse? There can't be, why is there so much evil in this world in place of God? You get that one a lot, don't you? I'm going to pose a question. I'm going to get a little bit heavy for you, right? Are you up for that? You might want to get your pen out if you want to mark it. I'll ask this question. You are making a moral, absolute moral statement by saying there's evil in the world. Do you know that? If you're saying there's such a thing as evil, then you're saying there's such a thing as good. Would you agree with me? Mm. If you're saying there's such a thing as evil and good, then you must pause at a moral law in which to differentiate the difference between good and evil. There must be a moral law. If you're saying there's a moral law, then there must be a moral law giver, and that's the one you're trying to disprove. This is Brother Zacharias, by the way. If there's no moral law giver, then there's no moral law. If there's no moral law, there's no good. If there's no good, there's no such thing as evil. What was your question? Your whole question just breaks down. It's not logical. Because if you're saying there's such a thing as evil, there must be a thing that's good. And that points to one who has placed in every one of our hearts a conscience. We all know what's right and wrong. People know how bad they are. You know that you're a sinner before God. People know how bad they are. They really do. It's just they don't want to come to Jesus. But they don't realize he's graceful and merciful and he can forgive you of all of your sin. Isn't that wonderful? So God has given us creation, Bible, and a conscience. He's given us far more than that, that we may know him. Rahab was aware of God and she had a fear of God. And I believe you, me, you need to have a fear of God because he's coming again. We're going to get there. Secondly, Rahab, was aware of who she was. She was a liar. She just lied to them. She also was a prostitute. Now you can imagine, some of the Jewish texts, they say that she, probably from the age of 10, she was a prostitute. Now, somewhere you think of Tamar in the Old Testament. She was put away by Judah, pretty much. Both of her husbands had died. And she, bless her, she was left. And then she literally tricked Judah into having his baby. But the thing is, with a widow, if you were put away, you had no way of having income. I'm not saying that Rahab is a widow, I don't know. But they had no way of earning any money for their family. So a lot of these women, and it's very easy to judge, a lot of these women had to go and had to get their money from selling their bodies. It's horrendous, isn't it? She was providing for her brothers, her sisters, a mother, and a father. So it's very easy to judge. But she was aware of who she was. And that didn't stop her from declaring the greatness of God, did it? That didn't stop her from knowing that this God was the one true God. And let me tell you, it doesn't matter who you are, what you've done. Sometimes I feel like Paul, I'm the chief of sinners. Do you feel like that sometimes? Doesn't matter. You come as you are. Yes, he is to be feared, but at this moment he is willing to forgive you of your sin and take you into the family of God. Firstly, she was aware of God. Secondly, she was aware of who she was. Thirdly, and this is where we're perhaps going to get a little bit heavy, she was aware of her need of salvation. You can imagine that she could have bartered with anything that she wanted to, because they had probably riches from Egypt. What was the one thing she asked for? She said, save us from death. Save us from death. That's interesting, isn't it? She could have asked for anything else. And we do that, don't we? We come to Jesus. Some people come to Jesus for, okay, he's going to give me my best life now. I just come mix with Christians because they're generous. I've just come to use whatever God has got for me. But that's not the gospel. The gospel is your awareness of God, your awareness that you are a sinner before God, and you say, Lord, deliver me from death, because I am going to die and one day I'm going to stand before you. That's where we need to come before God and realize that we need deliverance from death. Secondly, she was wanting her family to be saved. If you can't do it for yourself, if you can't come to Jesus for yourself, come to him for your family. I always had a fear of God, and I was aware of my sin when I came to Christ, but I was frightened for scalp. If I can't do it for me, I'm going to do it for her. Do you know my life, what you see before me, I'm really, a lot of it I'm doing to give Scout the best life that she can have, or best hope she has in Christ. Because if I don't get it right, I'm ruining her life as well. And I know many of you have families, don't you? Brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers. You have children, maybe. You owe it to them to give them that hope that is in Christ. You do. She wanted her salvation. It's interesting, isn't it? Every woman in the Bible that prayed got their prayers answered. Women get praying. Pray for me as well, if you like, if they're always answered. Get praying. Pray for your sons, pray for your daughters, pray for your brothers, pray for your sisters, pray for your fathers and mothers and grandparents. Pray! She was awareness of God, she was awareness of who she was, and she was awareness of her salvation. So they told her to hang this scarlet cord on her house. Get everybody in the house. And that's what we have to do. Just imagine what she did when she hung that cord. Bear in mind it was on the outside of the wall. She hung the cord down. The windowsill was red. She hung the cord down and it went vertically across the windowsill. I don't know whether that's true or not. That's what I see in it. Now you can imagine, who's waiting to come and destroy the city? Joshua. What's Joshua in Hebrew?
Yeshua.
It's the Hebrew name. Yeshua is the same name as Jesus, which means God is my salvation. You can imagine that. She's hanging that scarlet cord. Her house is going to be protected. Because Yeshua is coming. That wonderful picture. Do you know Jesus is coming? At this moment, he's looking to save you. Think what he did. He could have gone in and destroyed the city in one wipe. But what did he do? He sent two witnesses, which is like the Holy Spirit. That's what he's doing. And you may feel like Rahab. You might feel, well, how could the Lord save me? I'm like a prostitute. I'm a harlot before God. But he's sending his spies. I'm not calling the Holy Spirit a spy. But it's the Holy Spirit. He's seeking to save those who are lost. And he's willing to save you right now so that when he comes, you will have his righteousness and you will get into glory. That's my prayer for each and every one of you here, that you will enter into glory. The scarlet cord. Give me 5 minutes on the scarlet cord, okay? The scarlet cord is all shown in the Old Testament. Do you know the priests in the Old Testament, this was before Jesus shed his blood, they used to atone for sin by killing an animal. You all know that, don't you? The priests would wear a white robe, a linen robe, and they would wear a scarlet cord. Now it said on Yom Kippur, this is in the Talmud, which is the oral law, they would then split the cord, they would put one on the horns of a scapegoat, and one on the Holy of Holies. And they would chase the scapegoat out. And actually, by Jesus' time, they used to push the scapegoat off of the cliff. Does that remind you the way they, when they pushed Jesus out of his hometown, and they tried to push him off the cliff? Because Jesus is the scapegoat thief. And they said that when the sins, when this was done, when the sacrifice was made, the scarlet cord on the Holy of Holies, guess what color it turned? White. It is in the Talmud, and the Jews don't see it. And they said, 40 years before the destruction of the temple in 70 AD, it stopped turning white. Count back 40 years from 70 AD. Someone.
30
AD. Who died in 30 AD? Jesus. Do you know from that moment when Jesus gave his life on the cross, their Messiah, there was no forgiveness of sins through animals. They had to look to Jesus, their Messiah. And they completely missed him. I can't believe that. So here you have the scarlet cord. For sake of time, I'm going to skip a load of scarlet cords. But here, you see Rahab has their scarlet cord. She is saying, me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. We are going to serve the Lord. Now Joshua is coming. Joshua is coming. He comes in, he comes around the camp. I'm not sure if we'll do it again, if you want to do it again. I don't know. He comes around the camp and he blows the horns once. And then on the seventh day, he marches around seven times, blows the trumpet. And the walls come tumbling down. But Rahab's house, because of the scarlet cord on the wall, is the only part that's standing. I love that. I got an image when I was in there, when I was praying, when I was studying this. Put the scarlet cord in your house. Not physically, but for yourself and your household. Say, we are going to put the scarlet cord in our house.
Amen.
As for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. Because when Jesus comes, you're in safety. Love that. Sorry, I prayed that yesterday. Thank you for that. You're in safety. Now, it's interesting that Joshua said, go and get Rahab out of there. And then they're completely destroyed. It's a sign of judgment. Whether there's the Great Tribulation, bear in mind there's a shout, there's a trump of God, and it says all the men went up. Sounds like the rapture to me. It does. But he destroyed the whole city with fire. But Rahab was saved. Now the last thing I want to talk about is Rahab was a harlot, but she got a new identity. She was brought in. It says that she continues to be in Israel to this day. They welcomed her in the family of God. Do you know when you come to Christ, it says to as many as received him, he gave you the right to become what? A child of God. You have a new identity. Although me, I was a sinner. I've done some horrible things. I'm not a sinner. I'm a saint. Saint Simon. Alliteration with that. Saint Jerome. Wow, that sounds pretty cool, isn't it? Saint Michael. Oh, that's, I don't want to puff you up too much. That sounds pretty cool, isn't it? Saint Michael. Saint Gail. Saint Roger. You're a saint. You're a child of God. You have a new identity. Now, this is where I just want to end in this. The thing that blows my mind the most about Rahab is that although she was a harlot, she was given a new identity, and she was a member of Israel, she was a family of Israel, she married a guy called Salmon. And they had a child together named Boaz. That's another story. Ruth and Boaz is another picture of Christ. But then she was the great-great-grandma of King David. She was the great-great-great-great-great, 45, I think, times, grandmother of Jesus. Isn't it wonderful that Jesus is willing to have in his genealogy a prostitute? Don't think that you're too bad for Jesus. He's lovely. A prostitute is in the genealogy. And I think that's wonderful. So Matthew chapter 1, when you want to read it, whenever you go through that genealogy and you see Rahab, that shows us of the Messiah's love for us. Let's just quickly go over. Rahab was aware of God. She had a fear of God. Secondly, she was aware of who she was, a prostitute. Thirdly, she was in need of desperate salvation. She wanted her family saved. But fifthly, she had a new identity and a new start with Jesus. How wonderful is that? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the story of Rahab. It's not a story, it happened, Lord. And we thank you that we can learn from that, Lord, when we look at her, that wonderful woman who is now in the Hall of Fame, that because of her faith, that faith produced action to hide them spies, to put up that scarlet cord, that her household may be saved. As she is in the genealogy of Jesus, Lord, we thank you so much for that. And we just pray in here, Holy Spirit, would you reveal your Jesus to people who don't know you? In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for the cross.